Hello, I'm Roger, and this is Toffee. Welcome to our video. Today we're going to talk about wine tables. When you hear the phrase wine table, what comes to mind? Perhaps it's something like this. Or maybe something like this. Academics, auction houses, dealers, they all use this sort of technical jargon. But what does it really mean? In this video, we're going to talk about the origin of this term, the history of the wine table itself, its characteristics, and how do you recognize it from other forms of tables out there. So without further ado, let's talk about wine tables. This is a wine table. Using Putonghua, we would call this a jiuzhuo. Of course, jiuzhuo means just what you expect it to mean. Jiu means wine or alcohol, and zhuo means table. Put them together and you get jiuzhuo, or wine table. In order to understand what a wine table actually is, we need to talk about three different types of tables in total: wine tables, half tables, and painting tables. Let's start by talking about wine tables. First of all, where did we come up with this term, wine table? As we saw in the Sung Tomb murals at the beginning of the video, similar tables were depicted as having been used for food and wine. Thus, they became known as wine tables. Makes sense. And from reviewing ancient texts, we know this term was in common use at least by the Ming Dynasty, although the form itself dates back even further. Here's another example from the Five Dynasties period. This is from a very famous painting called The Night Entertainments of Han Xizai, which is essentially an ancient depiction of a minister's party life. Long story short, this is a painting of a night of party, straight up singing, dancing, eating, drinking, and partying. It's a very interesting story, but perhaps saved for another video. This particular version of the painting is in the Palace Museum, and is actually a later copy that was done during the Song Dynasty because the original was lost. What we see, though, is tables used for food and drink, and we can see what looks like two of them placed side by side together. So we know what they were used for in day-to-day life. Here we see another image taken in Beijing in the early 1900s by a German photographer named Hedda Morrison. I've upscaled the image, cleaned it up a bit, and colorized it using AI software. What we see, though, is a wine table being used by musicians playing in a funeral. It's a very practical usage. Here's another of a wedding procession in a courtyard taken around 1880. Also in Beijing. If we look closely, we can see two wine tables off to the side in the background. And once again, I've cleaned up and colorized this image with AI software. Let's talk about features. Many of these tables, but not all of them, will have a bead running along the outer edge of the top surface. This serves to prevent spills from leaking onto the floor. This bead's called a lanshuixian, which means something to the effect of water blocking line. And usually it's about 3 to 4 millimeters or so in height, or in inches, that's around 1/16 to 1/8 of an inch. Another feature that some wine tables will have, and again, not all, will be stone panels inset in the top. Much like the lanshuixian, this is a very practical feature in that this material surface works well when clearing away excess food and drink. However, this is not a rule, and wood surfaces abound in much greater quantities than stone tops. Nor are all stone tops original, as China-based restorers in the past were known to have refitted tables with stone in order to increase the attractiveness and thus saleability of the piece. So, if you have a stone top, this is something to keep in mind. Okay, let's look at a few examples that have been auctioned off. This first one is a Qing elmwood wine table. Notice the bottom shelf? This is a known form. And if you notice the price estimate, remember, this was in 1998. This second one is a very classical form in Huanghuali. And rather than use an inset stone panel on the top surface, they opted to use nanmu instead. And if you don't know what nanmu is, you can think of it as a kind of cedar. Here's another made of huali, although this one's actually huali veneer. Veneer, if you don't know what veneer is, it's basically a thinnish layer of wood applied over top a softwood frame. It's essentially a way to save on precious materials, although there are other reasons as well for using veneer, so it's not always strictly about cost. The red one that we see here is Kangxi era and decorated with incised lacquer and gold embellishments. It looks like something you would see in the Chinese paintings we looked at. And it's a good reminder that wine tables came in lacquered form as well. Now, this final one I included specifically because one thing to be aware of is if you're looking at auction house items, they may not always describe them the same way in English as they do in Chinese. So if we look at this Sotheby's piece, it's described in English as a tieli folding table. However, the Chinese describes it as a wine table, as a jiuzhuo. So this is something to be aware of. So other than the inset panels and the beading around the top surface, how else do we identify a wine table when we see one? Especially when talking about forms not as easily recognizable as the ones I've shown you here. Another way to recognize a wine table would be by the dimensions, because size and proportions are very important when talking about Chinese furniture. So, what we find here is that the width of a wine table is usually at least a bit more than half its length. Now, this is very important, but what does that even mean? Let's use a fictitious example. Let's say we have a piece that's 100 centimeters long. That would mean the depth is probably at least 50 or a little bit more than 50 centimeters wide. So this is a proportional indicator. Let's look at the dimensions of the previous table and use it as a real-world example. If we look at the proportions of this piece, we can see the size is 102.5 by 64 by 81.8 centimeters. In other words, the width is basically a bit more than half the length. So the proportions will tell you, particularly the depth. Now, if you remember in the beginning of the video, we originally said we needed to briefly discuss two other kinds of tables that could be similar to or mistaken for wine tables. These two kinds were half tables and small painting tables. Let's talk about half tables. Now, here's where it gets a little tricky. In reality, half tables are not that much different from wine tables. In fact, at times, many half tables were also used for food and drink in exactly the same manner as if it was a wine table. So one could easily understand why half tables are sometimes mistaken for wine tables, and vice versa. And that's fine. Chinese furniture is not a science. In Putonghua, half tables are called banzhuo. And again, the English is a direct translation with ban meaning half and zhuo meaning table. It's specifically called a half table because its name describes a narrow table that can be placed next to an eight immortals table, thus offering additional table space when needed. So think of this like the card table that you put at the end of grandma's dining table during the holidays to make extra space for everyone. Only instead of it being square, it's rectangular. Now, I just threw around the term eight immortals table, or bashianzhuo. What is that? The Eight Immortals of Taoism were a legendary group of heroes who lived on a secret island and fought against evil forces. So they were both mortal, but they also possessed superpowers, like the ability to heal or transform into other creatures. It's a bit like an ancient version of the Justice League. So a large squarish table that can seat eight people around it is hence called an Eight Immortals table. And yes, there is a smaller version called a Sixianzhuo, or Four Immortals table. Generally, the width of a half table is usually equal to about half the width of an eight immortals table. Another way to look at it is, if the depth of the table is half of its width, or even less, then it's probably a half table. Therefore, proportionally, half tables even look different than wine tables. They tend to be a bit more narrow and more rectangular. Historically, half tables existed earlier than the Ming Dynasty, but it was really during that Ming period that they began to appear in greater quantities, with their popularity rising even further during the Qing era. So it's for this reason that a fair number of them have survived into present day. They were often made in pairs and could be used with other tables, or perhaps placed on either side of a hall for displaying objects. Other times, they were simply used standalone, or as mentioned earlier, used in a similar manner to a wine table. And of course, as always with pairs, it's not uncommon for them to have been separated in present day. Now that we've talked about wine tables and half tables, let's touch briefly on the final form we need to discuss. Painting tables. Once again, the name alludes directly to its use. Hua zhuo literally means painting table. This is another old form that dates back to the Tang Dynasty or earlier, and they were used for scrolls, calligraphy, and things of that nature. The painting table was an indispensable study tool for the literati and scholar class, and it's the kind of furniture used by its owner mainly for artistic purposes rather than practical purposes. Therefore, painting tables were produced in lesser quantities than other forms. They were of the highest taste, and one might even say they embody the literati temperament itself. You can see why they are highly sought after by collectors today. Normally, painting tables are quite large because they're constrained by the needs of the materials that you're going to place on their surface. A scroll usually needs at least 70 cm of surface depth area in order to be worked on comfortably. Consequently, a painting table would normally be a lot larger and a lot longer than something as small as, say, a wine table or a half table. However, smaller painting tables do exist, so that's why we mention them here. But once again, if we look at the proportions, they'll always be an indicator, and we can see that a small painting table would probably be at least a bit wider and at least a bit longer than your average half table or wine table. Now that we have at least a rough idea of some of the differences between these three types of tables, let's leave you with one final example just to stir things up a bit and break all the rules. This piece proportionally looks a bit like a half table, although lengthwise, it's pretty long for a half table, and in that regard, it's probably closer to a painting table. And yet, it has an inset stone panel on the top surface, which makes one think wine table. Although, proportionally for a wine table, it's all wrong for that use. So, what is it? Maybe leave your answer in the comments below.
Hello again. You're back. Did you enjoy the video? Hopefully you haven't fallen asleep by now like Taffy has. If you like this video, consider to click like and subscribe so you'll be notified when the next video comes out. Until then, goodbye for now.